So welcome to the Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection webinar series. My name's Calvin Montague and I'll be chairing today's session. This is part of a series of webinars on soil-borne diseases presented by one of the horticulture innovation projects. It's VG15010. It's funded by Horticulture Innovation using vegetable research and development levy funds and funds from the Australian government. Just a little bit of housekeeping before I introduce Sarah. We invite you to ask questions during the webinar. You do this by looking at your left-hand column, or sorry, your right-hand column, and you should see a little tab called Questions. If you just click on that and then type your questions in it, they'll come to me, and I'll aggregate them up and then put them to Sarah as we go through the webinar. So please send them in during the webinar, and we'll aim to incorporate them into the presentation. So today we're talking about nematodes and vegetable production with Dr. Sarah Collins. Sarah is based in Perth, so she's a long way away. Hopefully the connection will hold. Sarah works with the Department of Primary Industry as a senior nematologist. She's also the secretary for the Australian Association of Nematology. And importantly, she's also been involved in producing this book here, which is the Management of Root Knot Nematodes in Vegetable Crops. And we'll refer to this resource quite a few times during the webinar. And I think, Liam, will be putting it on the link with the webinar as well. So it's a very useful resource. So Sarah, I'll hand over to you. And like I say, I'll drop in with questions from time to time during the webinar. So over to you, Sarah.
Hi. So I am from, as Kelvin said, I'm from the Department of Primary Industries in Western Australia. I work in the Plantology Group as a senior nematologist. And our group does research in horticultural systems. We also do research in broadacre cropping systems, and we offer help and advice expertise to our quarantine and biosecurity, as well as our diagnostics groups when they need our help. I've been invited to talk to you broadly about nematodes in horticultural systems, looking at both the plant parasites and also at the free-living nematodes, which are considered to be the more positive aspects of our soil health spectrum. Now, the research that I will draw on during this talk and the providers of basically the jobs that we have here are from our Department of Primary Industries, and we also, our main funding bodies have been Horticulture Australia Limited, or as they're now known as Horticultural Innovation Australia, and our other main funding body through our broadacre research is GRDC, or the Grains Research and Cropping Development Corporation. So when I draw on specific research results, it's most likely that I'm drawing on those two. I also do draw on a number of different photos and things that come from Mr. Google. So I've done my best to give you the website's addresses so that you can go and find out more information where you can for those. So when we're talking about nematodes, traditionally they were called eelworms. And these are, in a nutshell, small, simple, translucent, unsegmented roundworms. And nematodes actually make up a huge proportion of the animals that we have on the planet. I really like this picture here. I think it gives you a really good idea of a nematode, the size of a general nematode. This is a plant parasite here, in relation to a cross-section of a piece of cotton. So if you think that's a cross-section of a piece of cotton, and that's the size of a nematode in relation to that. And there you can see the same kind of nematode. This is actually a root-lesion nematode within a root system in this one. Now, nematodes can be wrapped up in forms where we can see them with the naked eye. This is actually a potato cyst nematode sitting in a root system, And this is the remnants of the female body, which becomes a cyst, which holds lots of eggs. And we can see those. They're about the only plant parasitic nematode types, the cyst nematodes, that we can see with our naked eye. So as I said, nematodes are in all aspects of our life. The largest proportion of nematodes are actually marine nematodes, and unfortunately we know the least about these forms of nematodes. They have nematodes that impact animals, and all the other nematodes that I have on this picture are actually different forms of nematodes that are in our soil. So we have bacterial feeders, fungal feeders, plant parasites, cyst nematodes. You can see these are the predatory nematodes that have wonderful big teeth that eat other nematodes as well. So when we put the nematodes back into the perspective of the soil profile, this is just Mike Hodder came up with these numbers, pretty much taken from his head, I think, but it gives you a good idea of what we could expect if we were looking at a moderately well-managed paddock. So obviously, depending on your soil, how you've treated your soil, whether you're a native environment or a managed paddock, will depend on the structure of the kinds of nematodes that you have present. So you will always, well, you should always aim to have plant parasites, fungal feeders, bacterial feeders. There'll be those that feed on other nematodes, that omnivores, and that whole spectrum of different nematodes.
So Sarah, just we did name the presentation is the good and the bad ones, and just to highlight that in the soil, in any soil, you'll have a whole range of different types of nematodes, and you know, when we generally the ones that get our attention are the parasitic ones, and it's generally when things get out of kilter that they start to become a problem, but they're generally mostly there. Is that right?
Plant parasites are a normal part of a healthy soil structure. And yeah, you're right. It's depending on the way that we have created these monocultures can tend to be more conducive to those plant parasites building up and actually getting to points where they can cause issues in our soils.
Thanks for that.
So when you look at a general nematode life cycle, you're dealing with a roundworm that it starts from an egg. It goes through a number of juvenile stations, and these juvenile stages will depend on the nematode species. And the adults will be the ones that are breeding. And as I'll allude to later on, quite often we only deal with females, certainly in the plant parasitic era. And it's usually in this egg format that we have resistant structures, or around this kind of idea that we have the resistant structures that help the nematodes get from one season or many seasons to another.
So Sarah, what causes the, or what induces the eggs to actually hatch and go into that larvae stage? Is it dependent on having a crop present that's susceptible?
Depends on the nematode. When you have some of the cyst nematodes, for example, will have a combination of both spontaneous hatch after a certain period of time when the conditions are more moist. You have other nematodes that will actually start to hatch in relation to having the root exudates prime those to become active. So it's generally based on conducive environment of both temperature and soil moisture. Because there are so many different types of nematodes in so many different environments, we tend to group them according to the types of feeders that they are. So the ones that I will be talking about in the soil environment are the ectoparasites and the endoparasites. So endo meaning those nematodes that go inside the plant root, and the ectoparasites are those nematodes that stay external to the plant root. I won't be talking about stem, bulb, foliar and seed gall nematodes. They are the ones that are above the surface, and I'll be concentrating on the soil borns. So when a lot of the nematodes that we're dealing with, certainly in the parasitic world, are the semi-endoparasites. So these are nematodes that can enter the plant root. This is actually the nematode, a mature nematode inside a plant root, and you can see she's been laying her eggs in the plant root. And the predominant feature of the plant parasites are this stylet or spear. And this works as like a, almost like a hydraulic pump, where the spear comes out of the nematode and actually punctures into the root cells and draws out the nutrition from the root cells. The other basic nematode type is the endoparasites, and these are the root knot nematodes and the cyst nematodes are our most common issues in Australia. And these forms of nematodes will either be born or hatched, I should say, within the root or enter the root, and then they actually will live their life in the root. They take their nutrition by basically tricking the plant into giving the nutrition to the feeding structure, giant cell in the case of a root knot, instead of to the plant cells itself. And as these nematodes mature, the female becomes the receptacle for the eggs for the next generation. This is actually, you can see, these are root knot eggs, these are the root knot body, and they're protruding out the external sides of the root. And the when you talk about the mechanical damage caused by nematodes, it's also that mechanical damage that of the nematode also opens up the plant root for issues from other pathogens once the root cells have been perforated. So the ectoparasites that we deal with are nematodes that have names like sting, stubby, dagger, needle, and these are the ones that can move from root to root and actually put their stylets into the plant root. This is the plant root here, and feed directly into the root. And these guys cause quite a lot of mechanical damage, and they allow entry of other pathogens and parasites into the plant root.
Sarah, that's a good point you make in terms of these nematodes often being associated with more disease complexes as well. And it's something that is observed quite frequently, and I guess that has implications for diagnostics. You've got to try and work out whether what you're diagnosing is the primary cause or whether it's something that's coming in on a secondary basis.
That's right, and certainly a number of the plant parasites that we look at in the broadacre cropping spectrum. I know that crown rot, for example, has often goes hand in hand with the root lesion nematode, and they create greater damage in those in paddocks in New South Wales where they exist together. So looking quickly and briefly at the spectrum of nematodes and how they can indicate your soil health. So when you look generally at your micro and macro fauna and flora within the soil, nematodes are a really important part of the soil, and they can be a really good indicator of what is going on in your soil. So if you think about it, if you have bacteria and fungi present, as well as the mites and the protozoa, then you will also have the nematodes present, which correspond to those. So if you have a lot of bacteria in your soil, you can expect to have a lot of bacterial feeders. And these are the sort of the bacterias, for example, bacterial feeding nematodes are those really just like bacteria themselves. They have the short bursts and steep rises in population and steep falls. So there, if you use nematodes are increasingly being used as an indicator of soil health, and there are some really good tests that are being developed to do that. I know that SARDI has been developing a good soil health test. where you can send a sample, they look at the DNA and indicate whether you have the longer living nematodes like the predatory nematodes and the fungal feeders through to the plant parasites, so you know what else is interacting in your soil. So these free living nematodes come in different forms, and as I say, the different aspects of what is happening in your soil will impact what free living nematodes are present. So if you we would describe a well modulated soil as a soil that would have that whole array from the longer living predators through to the bacterial feeders and the others present in the soil, as well as the plant parasites that we often get stuck looking at in particular. And just looking that in perspective of if you have nematodes present in the soil and you have a healthy soil, then you can also expect to have the things in the soil that will be preying upon the nematodes. So these are just some examples from to give you an impression of the kinds of things that also eat the nematodes in the soil. This is an example of a nematode trapping fungi, which actually lassoes the nematodes, if you like, and actually squeeze them and take the nutrition from the nematodes as they pass through. You have things, so this is another example of a fungi that is eating nematodes. Here we have a tardigrade, which tardigrades are often present in soil, and they eat a plethora of different things, including nematodes. And this here is actually an example of pasteuria, which is these little knobs that you can see on the outside of the nematode are the pasteuria, which actually parasitizes on the nematode itself and will actually suck the life of it out of it, so to speak. So there are all these different interacting aspects of the soil that we often, certainly in my aspect of research, ignore, but they are really important. And if you want to build a healthy soil, then these are the kinds of things that you'll be trying to draw into your soil complex.
Sarah, your pictures really highlight that it's a zoo down there in the soil. And there's lots of things happening that we tend to just sort of gloss over. But, yeah, you know, you talk about these free living nematodes as being indicators of healthy soil. What sort of practices are beneficial for building up the good guys? And conversely, what sort of practices reduce the level of the longer living predatory nematodes?
Building up the good guys, that's when you start looking at building up your macrofauna and flora as well as your microfauna and flora in your horticultural soil. So that's about things like composting, adding, using cover crops that will actually add to the soil environment. We often in Broadacre we look at things like lupins or ceradellas or pastures that actually have a positive nitrogen fixing effect, and also those plants that will leave behind lots of good organic matter that can start that cycling within the soil. And the negative aspects of it are those commonly applied fungicides and insecticides that are used to sometimes as fumigation or drenches, if you like. You have to remember that if you're getting rid of the negative aspects of your fungi, like Rhizoctonia and Takel and crown rot, you're also going to be getting rid of your positive aspects, and that goes with nematodes as well. Does that answer that for you, Kelvin?
I just wonder, in terms of veggie production, pretty heavily on tillage, what impact does that have on nematodes?
Tillage will It depends on the time of the season. Nematodes actually dry down, so tillage can be used to actually reduce plant parasitic numbers if tillage is done at a time that the nematodes are fragile. When the soil's moist, tillage won't have a big impact on the nematodes because they will move with the soil as it's being tilled. So now I've just generally given you an idea of the plant parasites that you will see most dominantly in our Australian soils. Although the nematodes themselves are microscopic, the impacts that you see once they get out of balance with the rest of the soil structure can be really immense. And I've just got some examples of the different styles of nematode plant parasites in horticultural and broadacre systems. And you can see here the symptoms in a paddock or in a banana plantation or in a vineyard. They are generally above ground symptoms will be of patching, severe droughting and smaller growths, chlorotic looking plants. And this is because the root systems have been severely compromised and the plant is not able to get the nutrition or the water that it requires to produce well. So just some of these. This is an example of a turf farm with sting nematode, banana plantation with burrowing nematode. This is a root lesion in a oat. I think this is dagger from memory in grapevines. And then we have a couple of different root knot nematodes. This is Melodogyne phalax. This I remember was Haplo or Javanica. And Javanica impacting different crops. You can see that with that really big knotting of the root systems.
Sarah, in terms of infection in the field for these parasitic nematodes, do you tend to get it clumping or is it sort of more uniform across the paddock?
Yeah, that's a really good point, actually, Kelvin. Nematodes are often... one of the things that makes them so nebulous to identify in a cropping system is that they tend to be patchy. So you'll get these patches of poor growth in amongst patches of healthy growth within a paddock or within a cropping area. Obviously, this is about the most nasty looking patch that you'd be looking for, but often it can just be an area that behaves badly. That you see that it wilts more easily or the plants are more yellow. And growers often put it down to, oh, I missed that section with my nutrient, or, oh, that's a bit of crappy, more sandy soil in my paddock, or over here it's about you might have more gravelly loam in that area. And it can actually be that's a nematode patch instead, and once people look below the surface, that they find that that's what the symptoms are from.
So really, the thing is to dig a few holes in your patches that are performing below par, and see if you can see any of the telltale signs on the roots.
It is that feature of. Don't forget to get your spade out and actually look below the surface as well as above the surface. So in Australia, we have a number of different both migratory endo parasites as well as sedentary parasites that are quite common. And these are some examples of the different genera that we have for those nematodes and their common names. So that's the root lesions, the root knots, cereal cysts, burrowing, sting nematodes, and they're the ones that impact different cropping types predominantly. I'm going to feature or talk about Pradalenchus or root lesion and Melodogyne root knot. They are arguably the two biggest issues that you have in horticultural systems across Australia. There are certainly areas that have other nematodes that are bigger problems, specific problems, but I think for this general talk it's good to just talk about these, the main critters that we deal with. So here I'd just like to point out, this is an example from Graham Sterling, who is the nematologist from Biological Crop Protection. This was Graham giving a talk in relation to turf, and he was looking at sting nematode. And different numbers of nematodes present in the soil. If you have a nematode, a plant parasite, as I said earlier, it's natural to have plant parasites in your soil. It's really when the balance gets knocked out and your plant parasites get to levels where they start to cause crop symptoms and crop root losses, and then that impacts yields. So as you can see, for some of these nematodes, you need a large number of them to start, and this is per 200 mil of soil. You need a large number of them within a soil sample, within a soil, to start causing problems. But some of these other nematodes, which are the larger, some of them are the larger, sting certainly is, you can deal with much smaller numbers where they start actually already impacting soil, your root health.
Sarah, with those thresholds, how robust, how well established are they?
Well, they are called thresholds because it is variable. Obviously, if you have a really well-managed soil and a really healthy soil, and you have good nutrition in the soil, all your ducks are in a row, so to speak, you may very well be able to, your soil and your plants may very well be able to deal with a higher number of amount of nematode pressure than a soil that is more deplete, where the nutrition is not good, for example, in a drying environment where some root pruning will have a bigger impact. So that can be really seasonally affected as well as soil type affected. So looking at the root lesion nematode life cycle, with the root lesion, as it's a migratory endoparasite, which means these little pink things you can see here are all actually nematodes, and this is a root, the root structure. You can see they go within the root, they can be external to the root, and the eggs can either hatch outside the root system or inside the root system. And as they grow, they start to cause lesioning and thinning of the roots dominantly. And these guys can have several life cycles within a season. So their numbers can grow quite quickly. So a small number of nematodes at the beginning of the season, once they, depending on the temperature and the soil environment, can multiply greatly over a season. These are the eggs, and then you go through those juvenile stations until you get an adult. And as far as root lesions are concerned, a lot of the root lesions only need the female. So this is part of the tricks of the trade that you have for the root lesions. First of all, a lot of the root lesions that we see only need females. So they are effectively clones. So they don't have to go through the sexual act to go from a small population to a large population in a growing environment. The other really important thing that they have is a mechanism called anhydrobiosis. And this means that as you have a drying soil environment, the nematodes actually also dry down as well. And then when the conditions are conducive and the soil moisture, the nematodes will actually rehydrate. And they can go through that drying and hydrating stage a number of times before they run out of steam. So for growers who have, this is why it's important for growers to not only look at what's happening in the soil during their cash cropping season, but also how they treat their paddock or soil environment between seasons, between cash crops. So I'm talking about here cover crops, weeds, whether you have fallow periods can all impact the numbers of the root lesion going into the next growing, a cash crop growing cycle.
So, Sarah, could I just get you to go back to that life cycle? So in terms of plant susceptibility, are young plants more susceptible to root lesion nematodes than older plants?
Ah, that's a good question. I'm not sure I have a good answer for that one. I think we often see the symptoms in the younger plants, but that is because the nematodes really become active as soon as the growing cycle starts.
So the root lesion respond to the exudates from the seedlings?
Well, it depends on the it really does depend on the nematode species and probably on the crop. So I do know that once, if you have a young crop and it may get, its roots may get pruned by the root lesion nematodes, depending on the health of that plant and its soil environment and its water inputs, will impact on whether that plant has the ability to grow away from the nematodes, so to speak. So whether it can deal with that root pruning and just grow through the area where the nematodes are, or whether it actually gets held up and completely stunted by those nematodes in the soil will depend on the plant health.
So within root lesion pretty much attack most plants, most vegetable crops?
Root lesion nematodes in Australia are really broad ranging, not only through our vegetable crops, they're also in cause issue in grapes, avocados, ginger. That's part of why they become such an issue, is they have such a broad spectrum of plants that they like to eat. They're not fussy.
And how many cycles would you go through, say, over a summer period? Like you talked about that
depending
breeding
on the soil.
Cycle.
Mm. Yeah, that really will be influenced by temperature and moisture. Mm. So the root lesion nematodes enjoy a warm, moist soil. So they're going to, we can understand then why they do so well in the tropical environments where they have that warm, moist soil for much of the year.
Yeah.
In cooler environments, like Tasmania or in the southwest of Western Australia, Victoria, in those horticultural areas, just as the plants tend to become more dormant during the colder periods over our winter, the nematodes too are relatively inactive. So they're, for us in Western Australia, they're really active in that spring and autumn period. And if they are in a horticultural crop that is being watered through a summer season, they certainly would be really active in those moist soils.
So if you're growing, say, a winter crop, then probably nematodes are not going to be an issue. It's more coming into the spring, summer, early autumn.
Oh, they can still be an issue in a winter crop, depending on the soil temperature. So as you know, the soil temperatures don't vary nearly as much as the ambient temperature. So it really depends on the temperature of the soil at the depth of the root system as to how active the nematodes are going to be. They certainly still have root lesion and root knot issues in Tassie, if that's any indication of the kind of cold soils they can deal with.
Yep. Well, that's about as cold as we've got to deal with. Thanks for that.
Some of the really obvious root lesion nematode symptoms that we get in carrots, for example, it's this kind of forking, or so these are both taken out of a carrot crop pretty much side by side, in patch and out of patch next to it, where you can see the size of the carrot that should have been there compared to the reaction of the carrot growth to the nematodes present in that soil. So these an example of some root systems in cereals, and it just gives you that impression that you get across crops where the nematodes have entered into the root systems. So you can see they're really lacking, all those lateral roots have died away or been eaten away. And you can see that the nematodes have been present in that, you get this thickening and thinning of the cortex of the root system itself. Now, when you have root lesion nematode and you have a horticultural crop, one of the projects that we worked on that was a national project was called Managing the Nematode Threat. And in Tasmania, Victoria, South Australia and Western Australia and Queensland, we did quite a lot of glasshouse trialling to look at what cover crops could be used for root lesion and root knot nematode. So what we found was that it depends both on the crop that you might look at as a cover crop, and also the cultivar can make a difference within a cropping type as to, and this is just an example from Pradalenchus penetrans, the resistance of that crop to the nematodes. So when we talk about resistance, if I'm talking about a moderately resistant crop and cultivar, I'm saying that in the life of that plant, we would expect, so in a season, we would expect that with that plant growing, that the nematode numbers would be reduced in most circumstances. When we look at a susceptible plant, we're saying during the growing of that crop, you would expect that to increase your nematode numbers. So if you have a paddock, for example, where you know you have root lesion and you know you need to manage it, it's not only putting in a susceptible crop. You might know that the crop that you want to have, your cash crop, be it tomatoes, carrots, potatoes, are susceptible. Then it would be important for you to look at what's happening between your cropping, cash cropping cycles to manage that those root lesions in between time.
Sarah, can I add to that too? Is not only your cover crop, but also keeping good weed control in that cover crop.
Absolutely.
Because a lot of times people will put cover crops in them with the main objective of trying to reduce either your nematode or your soil-borne disease. But if you have volunteers or weeds in that crop, then that can undermine your whole strategy. So you do have to be particularly careful with weeds. And whether they are hosts.
Yeah, that's right. And a number of the weeds, particularly when you start looking at the clovers and subclovers, there are a number of things that growers, in our more windy horticultural areas, often the grower, understandably, the main issue is keeping the soil down in windy environments between seasons. And so the main aim is to just have some sort of crop in there. And this is where things like clover have been put in by growers for a lot of good reasons. But if they have an issue with plant parasites from nematodes or other plant disease issues, consideration is really important about what they're actually using to keep their soil soil intact between seasons.
The other thing, Sarah, that I'd like to highlight in the table does it for us is that if you look at, say, oak, there are marked differences in the susceptibility of between cultivars. And that's something that seems to be very specific to nematodes. And we'll see this a bit further on with root knot nematode is you can't just sort of say, right, oats, you know, put oats in for root lesion nematodes. Well, you actually got to go down to a cultivar level.
That's right. And this is where across both root lesions and root knot nematodes, it's really important to know which species you're dealing with, because the actual crops and cultivars can be quite significantly differently, like they're impacted differently by the different nematode species. So it can be a tricky a tricky and thought-provoking process to figure out what's going to work best in your paddock.
And this is where it's actually quite useful to look across at the broadacre experience, because you know that you guys are screening lots of different cultivars to look across at their experience. And in this month's Ground Cover magazine, there was a supplement with a lot of information around different cereals and their susceptibility or resistance to nematodes, and that's worth a look at in terms of selecting a cover crop.
So now moving on to our root knot nematode, these are some of the kinds of symptoms that we've seen come through our labs. So when you're looking at root knot nematode, you get this is a tomato, you get this knotting of the root system. This is actually root knot nematode in banana roots. You can see the speckles there. They're actually the females have caused, and the knotting on the outside as well. This was a pumpkin. And this is actually, you can imagine what the root system, the knots on the root system look like once you start to get a potato that looks like this. This was caused by the species called Melodigyne or root knot, Melodigyne phalax, which is quite a really nasty bugger. This is actually a picture of one of the females that we took off this potato. This is the female. She's not matured yet into her cyst form, but this is her head, and she's now becoming, she would have her eggs developing inside her here, turning into the cyst. So again, looking at, just to give you an idea of, being aware of both your crop and how that's impacted by root knots, and also the other crops or cover crops that can be used in conjunction that will have less impacts. And this is gives you an idea. This is work that came from, this is the booklet that Kelvin talked about at the beginning of the seminar that we developed through that research project with HAL, Managing the Nematode Threat, where in South Australia, Queensland, and here in Western Australia, we ran a series of glasshouse trials looking at specific species of Melodigyne and their impact both on crops and the cover crops. So this booklet actually has a broad range of alternatives. And when you look at this, so this is going from resistant, highly resistant, to susceptible, highly susceptible. And this is our own results here from Western Australia. And the reason that you've got more than one rating here is because we ran more than one trial, and it gives you an idea of how things can change a little from trial to trial. But importantly, so if you look at the resistance of your crops, they can vary depending on which species of Melodigyne you have present. So it's important for you to know your beast. Once you know your beast, you know what you can start looking at, what you is going to work best for you as far as cropping, if you can change cultivars, or if you can look at what you do between cycles.
Sarah, I was going to jump in there because we've got a question here from Ian regarding plant nematode susceptibility or resistance, and what impact does environment / climate have on that? And you referred to that there's two ratings there with different conditions, different experiments. Mm. So are you seeing any sort of trends? If you've got, you know, favourable growth conditions, do plants tend to be more susceptible or more resistant?
Certainly season has a huge impact. Season and soil soil type, soil health, has huge impact. So as I referred to earlier, when you have a soil that is has more nutrition, has more pore spaces, more, you know, the soil environment is more structured, then your plant is going to be able to cope much better with having its roots impacted or pruned. And we can certainly in our research see that a plant in a more depleted sandy soil type with maybe a drier environment will be much more impacted by a small number of nematodes than maybe the same plant or crop in a moist soil environment with a different soil type can stand up to a really high number of the same kind of nematodes. So it does, it's a matter of you guys knowing your own backyard. So it's your crop in your soil in that season. So in some seasons, it would be much easier in a horticultural environment where if you're irrigated, in Western Australia, a lot of our horticultural growers are not irrigating in carrots and potato production, so they're a bit more impacted by the nature of the rain in the environment. But it really does make a big difference. So first of all, know your soil, and second of all, know what's in your soil, I think is the answer to that.
So generally, the more stressed your crop is, either due to water deficits or nutrient deficits, then or temperature not quite being right, then the more impact the nematode will have because it's damaging a greater proportion of the root system.
As we're going through these changing seasons that we've been having, where we are having some much warmer, wetter conditions. Certainly here in Western Australia, we've had a very funky winter season. When you have those warm, wet conditions, your plants are going to behave differently than they would in another season, where if it's not so warm and wet, that there might be a better balance with the plant against the nasties.
Mm. There's just another question here from Ryan on a similar theme, which is, if you've got really good root growth, will that just bulk up the nematode numbers quicker?
Yes, we do. We have had that issue in broadacre farming in Western Australia in the last few years. Certainly, a happy plant also means happy nematode. Mm. So you can imagine if you have a nice big plant root system, depending on the susceptibility of the plant, it may host a large number of nematodes but not impact the yield in that season. It may impact the yield in your next season if the season behaves differently. And I certainly, for us in broadacre cropping, what we find is that sometimes people putting in a crop like canola, for example, which is susceptible to root lesion nematode, they're increasing their nematode numbers in a crop like canola where they don't see any impacts, visually anyway, that do cause yield impacts. And the next season, they might have really poor crops because of what happened previously. So when you are looking at nematodes in relation to cropping, it's not a quick fix. It really is a management scheme that you have to put together and be prepared to jiggle around as time goes on. I suppose it's about developing the most robust soil environment that you can, so that your plants can deal with whether you've the numbers of nematodes, good and bad, that you have. So if I just give you a really short thinking time on soil nutrition and the nutrient inputs, I'm not going to talk very much on this, but just to sort of make you think a little bit about the inputs to the soil and how they're impacting more than just the plant that you're growing. So obviously nitrogen is a big one, and it's a really important input to give you nice, big, healthy plants. It does also have, of course, big impacts on your soil environment. And when you have good nitrogen levels, you'll also have good nitrogen-fixing bacteria. And nematodes are within this whole cycle. So when you are putting nitrogen inputs into your soil, just don't forget, I think this is what I'm trying to say, is don't forget how that's also impacting everything else in your soil. And sometimes when people aren't sure, they just throw more fertilizers at their plants, and that's not necessarily going to be a helpful, going to be very helpful. So just in relation to plant parasites, when you look at the plant parasites in this system, we know that a modification that happens down here in the breakdown of from the nitrites into the nitrates, the ammonification of the system, this is actually will reduce nematode numbers. But there's other things like putting flexi in on that have been shown to the nitrates, that the nematodes like the nitrates in the system, that could increase your nematode numbers. So it's this balance and flux and flow that you get within the soil that can be quite, we think, negatively impacted by some of the big nutrient nitrogen imports that are happening in the soil. So if it's not going to help your plant to the point, if you don't need it, don't use it, is probably an important thing to remember. So when you're looking at those upfront nitrogen inputs, they can be good and bad, which is probably a confusing thing to say. we've done work in our broadacre spectrum, which I think is quite relevant for certainly in Western Australia, looking at and inputs into your soil. When we look at liming of the soil in Western Australia, that's been done quite a lot in the broadacre spectrum. And we have found that it also has really positive impacts on the nematode increases, or stopping the nematode multiplication in the soils. So here, this is a root lesion nematode that we commonly have. And this is a glasshouse trial where we put different cultivars of wheat into and added nematodes. And this is soil from paddocks where you either the soil had been limed, which is the light blue, or unlimed, which is the darker blue. And as you can see, when you look at each of these cultivars, except for our one of our most susceptibles, is that when you had limed the soil, so changed the soil chemistry, the nematodes were unable to multiply as well as they did when the soil was more acidic. So we haven't actually done a lot of research into the trace elements impacts on plant parasites in Australia. But we've been thinking about it, and just to give you an idea of some of the things to be aware of as far as root exudation is concerned. So you're looking at the health of your root system, healthy roots compared to more leaky roots, if you like, and the things, the inputs that you might be putting into the soil and how they might be impacting your roots, and therefore how not only the nematodes can enter into your root systems, but also how other phytophthoras, rhizoctonia and other things can enter into your root system. So when you look at things like phosphorus, if you have high levels of phosphorus, you have less root exudation. These are things, I'm just going on the things that have been proven with plants. You'd imagine then that they'd be less attractive, because the nematodes are attracted, a lot of the root lesion or the plant parasites are attracted to those root exudates. So things like zinc deficiency, therefore, you have more leaky roots, you have more root exudation, and you'd imagine they'd be more attractive to the nematodes to find those roots within the soil profile. Zinc increases antagonistic microflora, for example, and phosphite, which I know through my background work, we phosphites used a lot now for jarrah dieback in Western Australia, for example, because it's known to increase the plant defence mechanisms. So then, you know, just transferring that on again to things like potassium, copper, calcium, they all increase resistance to penetration by making those cell structures more tough for so the nematodes or the other disease issues in the soil may find it harder to penetrate into the root systems.
Sarah, we've only got 5 minutes to go, so I just wanted to make a couple of points. One, in terms of nutrition, around the ammonia tends to be detrimental to nematodes. Yeah. But also we had that conversation earlier where if you've got a high nematode loading, then by managing well your irrigation and nutrition program, you can mask some of the impacts of that nematode damage as well.
Yes. Yeah. Certainly. So
we've got a question from Sandra regarding nematode diagnostics, and I think that might be in its next slide, so we might move on to that one.
So when you're looking at soil-borne issues in general, it's really important to gather as much information as you can, because they do tend to be nebulous, they do tend to be patchy, so it's important to look at all aspects of your paddock or a particular area in your paddock. So look at the weeds, look at your cropping history, look at the symptoms in previous seasons as well as what you're seeing now, soil type, fertilisers, they're all important to develop the picture. It's really important to get a correct diagnosis. So I've just given some examples here of some of the diagnostic services that I know are reliable. There are many others that are reliable, but to put no finer point on it, you do get what you pay for, and it's important to know the reputation of a diagnostic service if you want to use one. Once you look at
Sarah, will they give you both what species are present, but also that threshold?
If you go to a good diagnostic services, they should be able to tell you what nematode you're dealing with and what the threshold is, whether it's actually the predominant issue in your crop or not. Mm-hmm. So once you know what you have, that's when you can start looking around for both crops that are going to, how to manage it within your crop. Once you have plant parasites or they are at a level, then it becomes about management. Are you going to manage it with changing your variety? Are you going to manage it with looking at cover crops between? So this is when you start to build up your management practices over time. And you can incorporate looking at cultivation, organic amendments. There's a whole series of things that you can do to build your soil structure and reduce your plant parasites to manageable levels within your paddock so that it is not impacting your yields. And there are a number of chemical controls around. I haven't gone into that at all because it's not an area of my research. But just be aware that there's a number of chemical controls. They will impact your good and your bad. And they will you won't get, once you have plant parasites to levels that are bad, it's about management. You can't get rid of them. You just learn to live with them, and you can live well with them.
That's me, Sarah, I've got a question that, you know, when we talk about a lot of these sort of soil-borne diseases, we talk about biosecurity, but for nematodes, they're pretty much universal. Every soil you look at will have the whole spectrum of nematodes in them, from good guys to bad guys.
Oh, so there's no. We certainly do have quarantine nematode pests to watch out for. There are a number of, certainly anything that's soil-borne, unfortunately, is easy to bring into our country on soil, on feet, on equipment. And we also have specific nematodes that are present in some states and not in others. So it's not a simple process. We do have a lot of native plant parasites in our soils, but I certainly say to growers who might have even a root lesion nematode issue in one paddock, just to be aware of that when they're moving their machinery from paddock to paddock, because they can build up, you can build up your numbers between one paddock and another over time. So we do have plant parasites, but certainly not all plant parasites.
So you do want to be using biosecurity as one of your tools to minimise the spread.
Yes.
Okay, I'm just going to wrap it up there, Sarah. Thanks for that presentation. The presentation will be available on our website, on the Soil Wealth ICP website, and I think you'll be emailed out a link to that, so if you want to look at it or share it or get any information off it. I'd also just highlight this Root Knot Nematode booklet again, and I think that'll be in the link as well under the resources. It does cover a little bit off about the chemical control, and we did specifically leave that off this presentation because you should really be talking to your agronomist and your chemical supplier to check that it's on label, check that it's got some efficacy, and just be careful with how you use some of the products. For example, some of the fumigants, if you repeat use it, you will see a drop off in performance as the biodegradability of that product starts to increase. So you do have to manage your chemicals as well. And that's why even if you're relying on chemicals a bit, you should be trying to use it within a whole system of using rotation and cover crops and soil health as well, just to make sure you extend the life and efficacy of that chemical. So again, thanks to Sarah Collins over there in WA for sharing her insights and knowledge on nematodes. I would draw your attention that there are a whole series of the webinars now on Pythium, what else have we got? Pythium, Sclerotinia, nematodes, and I think we've got another one coming up with Len on Fusarium fairly soon. As well as that, there's also some stuff on nutrition and soil-borne diseases. So have a look on our website for those. So again, thanks to the participants for signing on and for asking the questions. I hope we've addressed them. And thanks, and look forward to seeing you at the next webinar.